Welcome back to the Profit Builder. I am so excited to have you here. And today we're going to be talking about marketing and specifically about how do you look at the marketing side of your business in order to have a consistent set of practices in that area of your business. And it is the second piece in our Stop the Profit Leak series for contractors. And in my last video, I talked about all of the places where profits can leak out of your contracting business. And this is the first video in the series that will actually take a deeper dive into each area of your business, starting with marketing. And I'm very excited to have my guest, Spencer Powell, here today to talk about this. And I'm going to go ahead and share the video and let you jump in. I'm super excited to have my guest, Spencer Powell, with Builder Funnel here with me today. Spencer and I know each other from a mastermind group that we're a member of, the Construction Consultants Mastermind Group, and he is a marketing genius for contractors. So first of all, Spencer, thank you so much for being here and being a guest on the Profit Builder.
Thanks, Vicki. Yeah, I'm excited to have a conversation today.
Yeah, me too. You know, the whole, you know, Spencer and I were talking last week, and I'm gonna ask you to introduce yourself in just a second. But you know, we were talking last week about marketing and how it's so funny that when contractors are super busy, they tend to go, I don't have time. Like, I'm just answering the phone. Like, I couldn't take on any more work. And so they do no marketing or very little marketing. And then things start to slow down, like we're starting to see. And then what happens is revenue starts to go down. And what ends up is like, it's like this roller coaster of revenue. And part of what we were talking about is how do you avoid doing that? And, you know, I remember a really long time ago, somebody who was a very successful contractor kept saying to me over and over again, market when you're busy, market when you're busy, market when you're busy, so that you don't have that happen. And as we were talking last week, you know, you and I started talking about there's short game marketing, like short term, like how do you quickly turn leads or generate leads that turn into opportunities to make offers. And then there's what's a long-term strategy, like how do you talk long-term and what are the ways that you invest and how do you make sure that you're intentional and strategic about how you market? Because there's so much stuff out there these days, like that we all hear about, you should do this and you should put Facebook ads and you should be on social media and you should be on Instagram, like, and you should, you know, get your Google ratings up and so on and so forth. And so I said, you know, when we were talking, I said, hey, will you come talk to people about that? Because I think that's one of the things that we kind of get overwhelmed, that we end up doing this shotgun approach to marketing, and then it, like, it's frustrating because it's not actually making the phone ring. And so Spencer has been gracious enough to offer to come and talk with us about that. And but before we jump into my questions, would you just introduce yourself, tell people a little bit about you and your background and how'd you come?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Well, I'm Spencer Powell. I'm the CEO at Builder Funnel, and I really got into the marketing game about 13 years ago, working with my uncle's company. And we took their remodeling division from about 2 million to 10 million over about 4 years. And primarily when digital marketing for this industry was in the early innings. So Facebook business pages were new. There was no Instagram, no house, definitely no TikTok. And it was like early days of blogging and SEO and trying to get found online for people searching for kitchen remodels or that sort of thing. And so today we're solely focused on, you know, construction space, generally design, build, remodeling, interior remodeling, custom home builders. And yeah, we're a team of about 22 spread all over, mostly full-time remote at this point. And yeah, that's a little bit about us.
Thanks. You know, one of the things I really appreciate about you is that you've been in the industry, you've worked in the industry, you were part of the, hey, we did this and it made revenue go from, what did you say, 2 to 10 million? Mm-hmm. So like you got boots on the ground of experience and having done this, not to mention a long track record, I know, of having created amazing success with clients. So I just appreciate that you understand your customer really well from the inside out, right? Yeah. So here's my first question. You know, why is marketing strategy important? And because, like I said, you know, I think that people think the word strategy and they're like, you know, and they listen to all this noise out there. So maybe you can talk about why is it important? Yeah.
This is, I love this question because, and I've really been digging into it actually a lot lately. And we help our clients on the marketing side. And so we build marketing strategy plans, and then we also will help with execution of the tactics once we get to that point, if they want our help. And we've been doing this for a while. And the more I dig into that part of it, the more I realize that I think where we're headed is actually just helping people figure out a lot of other pieces too. And one of those being company strategy, because if you think about marketing strategy, you're going, okay, well, what do we want? Like, who are our best clients? Like, who do we want to attract? And then you're like, well, okay, this is the type of client. They make this much. They live in these certain neighborhoods, whatever, you know, we can drill into that for forever. But then you go, okay, well, and then what are the types of projects that we want to take on? And that's part of it too. So, okay, we do kitchens and baths and whole home, or we do, you know, outdoor living, or, you know, whatever it is. And I talk to so many companies, and you can go to their websites, and it's like, we do kitchens, we do baths, we do basements, we do whole home, we do decks, we do, you know, outdoor living space. And you're going, well, gosh, that's going to be tough to market. And not only just because there's tons of different things that you do, so you got to be able to market and position all those. But then when you actually think about being unique and different, and that's something that as marketers is really important, because it's like, what are we actually positioning against here in the marketplace? Now you kind of look like everyone else, or you look like a generalist. So if you take that person that does six different things, and then you go to the kitchen only company, if somebody's looking for a kitchen and they're comparing three different companies, the one that stands out is the one that only does kitchens. And you know what? They're saying no to everybody else. So that's like where strategy, like company strategy, actually starts to overlay with marketing strategy, because you've intentionally said, we're only going to do kitchens. We're going to get really good at kitchens. So we're actually going to be able to command a premium price because we're better at it. But then you actually are more efficient operationally. And so you actually build in more margin because you're faster. And then you deliver a better experience. And so you get better reviews, you get more referrals, and then that cycles back into marketing. So anyway, I could keep going, but I just want to give a little hint on like company strategy, yeah, marketing strategy, and the overlay there.
I love this, because just this morning, in my contractors collective group, we do this section where we do masterminding, and the guy who was on the hot seat had, like, his whole thing was, how do I deal, you know, make sure that I'm not having a battle with people who go, well, I can get it cheaper here, or I can go there, or, you know, I'm not sure if you can really do it, because he's a bit of a generalist and a whole bunch of things. But then also, what was great is the group said to him, listen, you need to know who your customer is and who your customer isn't, and be clear about the lane that you're in. Because like you said, when you're a generalist and you're all over the place, you're less efficient in operations, right? Because your team one day is doing decking, one day doing siding, one day doing kitchens. But if you focus on a particular area, it helps you niche. And it was kind of the exact same feedback that the group gave him, which was, decide who your customer is. You're not for everybody. And the more you can start to make that distinction, the more you can stand out from the competition, and that you can rise above all of the rest of the rhetoric. So I love that. And I've seen that over and over again too, Spencer, and I'm sure you have too, like with clients that I've worked with, who, when they get really clear on who's our customer and who's not our customer, it helps them be more focused, and it has them be more intentional about what they're doing. But B, it stops having them try to be a yes for everyone, which is exhausting, right? Like when you're trying to be everything for everybody. And I know that's true I remember going through that transition for myself and my business too. And it was like, all of a sudden marketing got way easier.
and that's exactly what I was. Yeah, I was just going to say that when we first started, it was a division of my dad's direct mail company. And so we had been working with my uncles growing that business, but we also had clients in other industries as we were just getting into digital marketing. And a few years in, we just went, this is a nightmare. And so we just decided to focus on that area where we had, you know, the most success and, you know, the most experience. And to your point, you said marketing got easier, but marketing was easier. Sales was easier.
Yes.
delivery was like everything gets easier. Yeah. And then suddenly we realized we weren't actually attracting dentists and lawyers and whoever else that needed help with digital marketing. We were only attracting, you know, people in the industry, and it makes sense because that's what you're marketing to. So,
yeah. Yeah. And yeah. And then also a final note about that, like then people think people see how you understand their world. Right? Mm-hmm. Like, so when I started focusing just on construction, it was like, then I became an expert in the industry, which had me stand out, you know, from the competition. And you, when you focused the same thing. In terms of, I know there's another question I'm going to get to here, but I just have a question in terms of strategy. Do you have a recommendation of how somebody would approach going from like coming up with their internal strategy so that then they can figure out a marketing strategy, like a strategy for who's their customer? Do you have like recommendations, and then how do they start to transition that into, because I know we're going to talk about long-term and short-term strategy for marketing, but just any final thoughts about to help people be able to take this idea and then move it into an actual plan?
I think it does take a little bit of soul searching and then just some hard looks at projects that you've done where you typically either one, make the most money so you get better margins, which usually means either are more efficient there or you command a better price or whatever the reason is. But two, where your team skill sets are, and those are probably correlated most of the time. And then the other piece of it is just who are the types of buyers and clients that we want to serve. And so good example of that, I was talking to a custom builder yesterday, and we were talking about how when he first got in the game, the custom homes that he was doing were in that like 600 to 800 range. And then it kind of moved up to 8 to 1 million. And then where he's at today, he's basically, they're like, well, the market's kind of turned. So do we want to go back towards, you know, that like 600 to 800 range, but now you're kind of competing with a lot of the like big builders that are just, you know, pushing stuff out. And so they decide to go north, you know, like we're going to push towards the people that are doing 2 to 6, 2 to $10 million homes. And part of his strategy there was the people that can afford that, they usually are cash buyers anyway. They're not impacted by downturns as much. Like, you know, if somebody's a billionaire, like that's like pocket change, I think was kind of the analogy he used. And so, again, that's strategy and thinking about like, who are the clientele we want to serve long-term? And if you pick a market that is more price sensitive, then you know you're always going to be battling that, and you're going to have to build your margin around efficiency. But that's a strategy, right? There's room for everyone. So I think it's a combination of where you make your money, where what your team skill set is, maybe where your interest is, and it's some blend of all of those. But I think the easiest way to start is just thinking about where you're currently successful and just trying to get more of those projects and less of the other ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I think that you made a really good point. Is your team most efficient? Where do you make your highest margin? And then, you know, the other question I oftentimes ask people is, what's the most fun?
Like, totally.
Projects that you really most like doing that you get the most satisfaction with, because those also tend to be jobs that you tend to sell better.
Yeah.
You know, because you have more of a passion for it. So.
Yeah, awesome. For sure.
Let's talk about short-term, long-term marketing strategies. So what are some short-term marketing? Well, before I jump into short-term, long-term, let's talk just for a second, if you will, speak to long-term strategy versus short-term strategy. And it's what I think of short-term strategy as I say to people, what's the lowest hanging fruit? Like, what's the thing that you can, that like I can get them into the pipeline and I can turn them into a job versus I'm out there long-term, like I'm being in the right places at the right time so that when people are ready to go look for a contractor, they have found me. I think of that as like long-term, but maybe just, will you just speak a little bit more to that from your perspective, what long-term, short-term marketing strategy, and then let's talk about each one of them. What are some strategies for each of those?
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good question. Let's back up a half step too, because I feel like a lot of contractors, when we think about getting leads, The best type of lead is like a referral, you know, something that was word of mouth. It was passed off, right? A recommendation. And then you see this evolution where people go from, they've built their business on word of mouth referral. And then they're like, now I'm kind of hitting this wall and I need some marketing. And then they start doing some marketing and they start getting some leads, and they always think the leads are junk. The leads are garbage. Right. And the reason is the referral lead comes to you with something built in, trust.
Right.
So the sale is easier and you get the project. With a marketing generated lead, somebody is probably comparing and they don't know who you are. So you are starting from trust zero. So back to your question, when I think about a long-term marketing strategy should build trust so that by the time the buyer is ready to have a sales conversation, they've got some trust already built and you're not starting from zero. And that's what a long-term strategy can do in terms of warming up a lead. We also just have
distinction, by the way. That's awesome.
Thank you.
I love that.
Yeah, because I kept hearing this over the years, like, oh, internet leads are junk, or marketing leads are junk, I'm like, well, no, they're not junk. They're just in a different buying behavior. And so actually what it is you're not actually that unique, and you don't have a strong sales proposition because they're going to close at a lower ratio. You're losing to price more often. And it's like, well, why is that? And why do the referral leads close at your normal prices? The trust, like, you've already built that trust. And so again, back to the long-term strategy, this is why I'm such a big believer in content marketing, education style marketing, blogging, video content, podcasts. Like, if you're a remodeler and you start educating your audience on kitchen trends and how long it takes and what it costs and where you get the biggest bang for your buck and where you can maybe, like, if you're on a budget, you can make these types of decisions. And then somebody like is thinking about their kitchen and they find you in January and they're reading and they're following your stuff and they're like, wow, this is super helpful. And then when they're ready to make a decision, now they're ready to talk. Maybe it's summer. Now they reach out to a couple of companies, but if they've like seen your face, been reading your stuff, getting your emails, you're at trust 10, 20, 30 instead of zero where the other companies are. And so that's where I think the power of like a long-term content marketing, brand awareness strategy. It is lead gen just over a longer time horizon, and nobody wants to wait that long. I've had people where they've been following me for 3 years and we get on a 30-minute call and they're like, let's roll. Because they know me. I don't know them, but they know me.
One of the things that I like that you're talking about is that, a lot of times we think long-term strategy, like I have to do SEO, I have to get my Google ratings up, I have to, do this in social media and that. But what you're talking about is even when you're doing all of those things, one of the things is that you're building, I have two thoughts in mind. One of them is like you're building know, like, and trust. And that the more you can look at it, like, my goal isn't just to do stuff out there. Cause I remember I used to think that, like, if I just do this, this is the right thing to do. But what you're talking about is taking that effort a step further and building know, like, and trust and getting in front of people enough times that they have that with you. And, I remember, and maybe you have just different statistic about this, but I remember they used to say, if in the days of print advertising, newspapers, magazines, billboards, people just had to see your name 7 times to build name recognition. And the last stat I heard was like, now it's like 17 times in order to build any kind of name recognition, which builds some know, like, and trust. Is there a different statistic on that these days?
I've heard that same one about reps, and I actually like a different one today. I'm not discounting that one. I think there's a lot of validity to just like repetitions, but I don't have the stats on this, but when you look at branding, one of the most important elements of like me developing brand recognition or an affinity to a brand or like the know, like, and trust with a brand is actually time spent. And so when you think about like seeing a Coke commercial and you've seen it 100 times, like you're stacking up all these like 30 seconds, like now I've got 10 minutes with Coke or whatever. with videos, with podcasts, like you can stack up hours of time with somebody. Like I encourage anyone to just think about the podcast that you follow regularly and listen to, or the YouTube channels that you follow regularly. If you listen to a 30-minute podcast every single week for a year, you probably spent more time with that podcast host than maybe some of your friends that year. Think about how much trust, likability, connection you've built, even though the host has never met you. So I like that time spent metric and thinking about that, because that's what's really going to implant it, you know, in somebody's brain. If they, I mean, they could spend 1 hour listening to a podcast, and that might be one touch, but it's 60 minutes, and that's pretty powerful.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Well, so let's talk about what are some short-term marketing strategies, tactics, and then long-term.
Yeah, I think the short-term stuff, it is more challenging because you're basically like, I need to just instantly generate, you know, demand now. And so when I think about that, it's going, okay, I've got 100% of the market for people that are looking for kitchen remodels. 4% of those people are what we call active buyers. They're like in the decision-making process. They want to get a project moving. So it's like, how do we find these 4% right now, get them into my pipeline and like convince them to sign up with me? And so when you think about that, I mean, Google Ads is one of the best ways, I think, because you can go to Google and you can say, I want to show up for these certain keywords. And if I'm saying, I know somebody in Colorado Springs is typing in kitchen remodeler in Colorado Springs, like they're probably looking for a kitchen remodeler to do a kitchen project, right? So there's certain terms that we would call, like they have high buying intent behind them. There's no guarantee they're going to do a project or anything, but if they're typing that in, like there's a good chance that they're actually one of those active buyers. So Google Ads, that's going to be probably a higher cost per lead. Like you're competing against other companies spending on ads, and all that money is just going direct to ads. And then once you get them to the page, like you got to make sure there's a compelling page, you convert them, you get them into your pipeline. And then again, you have zero trust. So what are you doing in the sales process to, you know, show your value prop, move them through the sale and get them to close? So there's some hurdles there, but
yeah. Can you just speak to that a little bit?
Which part?
You did, and I know that we're on one little strategy here called Google Ads. So you had good placement, you showed up on the top of the, you know, the first fold, above the fold, the first screen. But the sales process, give us just a few, because I have this whole thing I do with people that talks about like, how do you nurture people through it? I'd love to hear your thoughts about what are a few things that you go best practices once your cycle?
Yeah. So let's say somebody does that Google search, they click the ad, they land on your site, and then they fill out a form. They're like, I want to contact us, schedule a quote, you know, whatever, schedule a consultation. So you book a call, and it's pre-qualification call, could be with the owner, with the office manager, whoever does that intake, right? Like that's your first connection point with this person. They did a quick search, land on your page, filled out a form, 30 seconds. They don't know anything about you. Hopefully then they browsed around your site, did a little bit more research, but like they honestly might've just done the 30 seconds, click, 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 and they're in. So that's really where I feel like, you have to ask good questions, identify if they're a good fit. And then if they are a good fit, then you have to do a really good job of showing the process, outlining, like making that person feel like, wow, these guys have done this before, and then tee up the first meeting, right? Because that's really what that process is about. And then once you get to the first meet, we could go on from there, and that's the whole sales process, but really.
So part of what, like when I'm listening to you, and I think that you may have spoken to this a little bit ago, it's like part of that is the, it's an education and it's a value-driven conversation. It's not a sales, like people, sales, that four-letter word. But what it is it's a more of a consultative approach to how you're actually engaging in that conversation, which creates more know, like, and trust with you. And I always say, like, questions are such a gift that we give people, because when we ask them questions to help clarify, we help them get more clarity. And when we have more clarity, we have more confidence. When we have more confidence, we take more powerful actions. And that's really like when we look at it, not like I'm trying to prove myself, but what I'm trying to do is make it, like if I approach that with it's about helping us and them be clear, is this a right fit?
So, 100%.
All right, yeah, I know I got off on it. We got off on a little bit of a tangent there, but I think that's important. Like, once you get them in the door, have a process, and it is about educating and guiding them and building that know, like, that's where that know, like, and trust continues.
Yeah.
So Google Ads.
Yeah, so that's the like paid short term, and then I'll give you the free short term. And I would say it's typically one-to-one emails to past clients, architects, referral partners, real estate agents, designers, whoever's in your network. Hey, Mary, Spencer, over the last few years, we've done a great job of, you know, transforming people's homes, and we've gotten great reactions. And like, we're really making an intentional choice to grow this year. Right now we have X spots available for, you know, large scale remodels. I'm wondering if you know anyone that we should be put in touch with. Send that out to 10, 20, 30 people that are in your network, get some stuff back. And then you can do just continuing like email newsletters to your existing database. But like, I think that one-to-one personal outreach, you can, the email basically says we need work, but we've reframed it as we're trying to serve an audience, which is hopefully what you're trying to do, like transform people's homes in a positive way, which is hopefully what you're trying to do. And so it's a very genuine email, but it's said in such a way that says like, this is how many projects we have available. And I heard this recently and I thought it was really powerful. If I just dumped 200 projects on your lap today, like, could you handle them? Most people would say no. So what is the number? And whatever the number is, go out and tell them that.
Yes, I like that.
I can handle 4 projects right now. I'm looking. So now you're building some exclusivity. Anyway, there's a whole psychology behind that, but
yes.
Just tell the truth. Like, this is what we're looking for, and this is how many projects we have available, but it's positioned much stronger, and you'll get some activity out of it.
Yeah. What I like about what listening to you, Spencer, is it's having the contractor, business owner, marketing person think from the perspective of A, being intentional, and B, being purposeful about like, well, how many can I really handle? And I love that it's tapping into referrals, who are people who already have no like and trust with you. So
I want to add one more note on that. I think it was if we have time, going back to what you started at the beginning of this was something about the roller coaster, right? Like when we're busy, we never want to market. And then when we're slow, we're like, oh my gosh, we need marketing. We need leads.
Yeah.
I find the interesting thing about that is that almost every company I talk to wants to grow. And when you're busy, if you want to grow, that would seemingly be the time to force that growth. Because if you're busy, you're just full. And then really the goal is just that you would stay busy. But if you want to grow, you actually want to be more busy, but you have to figure out where your constraints are. So when you're busy, you should really say, let's step on the gas. And then that's going to force me. Now do I need to hire this person? Do I need to install this new system? Like, how could we do 30% more work? But it's weird because everyone gets busy and then they're like, I'm so busy, I can't handle anything, but yet they want to grow. So I would just encourage people to think about like, do you really want to grow? And if you do, what are the committed steps that you're taking to do that? And it probably means hiring and pushing into those busy seasons. Anyway, just a general comment.
Oh, good. Thank you. I'm glad that you brought that back together. I think that's a really important point. Let me ask you. So the let's talk about long-term strategies.
Yeah. I think the long-term strategy that I've seen most successful, and I mostly operate in the digital space, is the educational style content marketing. And so that's blog content, that's project spotlight pages where you tell real stories, that's video content, that's podcasting, like all of those are content pieces. They're just different mediums. But again, if you think about your ideal clients and what they're searching for, like there's a lot of educational components to what we do and the knowledge gap between the homeowner and what you know. And so it's really just sharing your information that you know about, you're an expert in. The homeowner is not the expert. And it's all the questions you get in the sales process. It's all the things that come up when you're delivering the project and they have more questions and they're like, what's going on at this stage or what's happening now? Or if you just build into your DNA and your philosophy that you're going to be an educator around best practices and how do you get successful projects done and all of those details that the homeowner cares about and home maintenance things after the project, things that they should be thinking about, you do start to build that know, like, and trust. And you also start to rank in Google if you're doing it right. So like you start attracting more and you'll have a lot more people in your world that are not in that 4% active buyers today. But then 3 months later, 9 months later, 3 years later, somebody will pop into the sales funnel and they'll be like, oh, like, I'm so excited. We're finally ready to do our kitchen. I've been following you guys for years. Like, you have the best content. You're always so helpful. I feel like I know your team already. And I'm saying these things because I hear them. Like, yeah. I've experienced this. And that's the long-term, like, brand connection. You're part of the community. You're doing more than just
service. Okay, so here's a million-dollar question.
Okay.
We could write content all day long. Right. I could have a podcast. I could have a blog. I could have a newsletter. The question is, how do I get it to the ideal reader? Like, what's like, there's like a whole, yeah, I mm-hmm. could do it, but then what you do with it is the difference that makes the difference. So can you just speak to that for a minute? Because
yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Big question, right? But the basic premise is, it goes back to kind of what we talked about with keywords and target audience. So if you have an ideal client and they're researching kitchens, we've just been using that as the example, they have lots of things that they type into Google. Questions: how much does it cost? What are the current design trends? What's the ideal layout for a four-person family? What's the, you know, like, you could think of a bunch of those, and you can do research on these keywords to see how many searches are there every month and all of those types of things. So what you're trying to do is say, my ideal client searches for these types of things, so I'm going to start addressing those questions and topics that are connected to those keywords, but I'm going to write them, I'm going to use the keyword, but I'm going to write them to the user, to the person. Like, if I was just talking right to you, I'm going to explain it like I was explaining it to a real person. Then you'll start to rank for those things. And so when people type them in, they'll start finding your stuff. Okay. That's the attract. And then there's also the promote. You have an email list. You have a network of architects and trade partners. When you create a piece of content, send it out via email to your database. Now people in your world are now getting access to that content. And then you can use social as another way to like spread that content and promote it. So people that follow you on social, let me share this content I created on my website, because they don't know it just got published. So you got to go let them know, post it on social. So those are just some very basic steps, but that's the premise.
Okay, good. So you made a really nice distinction there, because one of them is attract. So mm-hmm. Let's just use it as an example. You're doing some kind of a blog post once a month or twice a month, whatever, maybe every week. And you put it on your website and you're writing that like you're writing to a homeowner that's addressing a real life question or issue that they may face. So you could look at any one of your clients that you've served over the course of your business and write a story about it. And then by having it with certain keywords that are going to be the keywords that your ideal customer, again, goes back to what's my strategy, who am I going after?
Correct.
Yep. Look for, you start to attract people coming into your world. Love that. And then the second way that you said in terms of long-term strategy is doing outreach. So you're creating maybe a newsletter, maybe that, you know, sharing that blog content, which is actually super easy to do if you have a mailing list, right? So you can then just send that out to your list, and basically it's all value add, education based, supporting that ideal target client to have more know, like, and trust of you, because you've helped educate them and have them build their clarity and confidence so that they're going to want to maybe work with you.
100%. Yeah. It's the attract and then distribute. And if you think about that piece,
okay, that was the word you used. Yeah.
If you think about that piece where they're like on your email database and you're like, oh, I don't want to bug my audience. Well, it's like, well, then rethink your content, you know, because if the content is truly adding value to them, educating them, you almost can't do too much of it. You could blast them like every day and they might not appreciate that. But again, if it always is helping them, then they're going to get a lot of value out of it. And so it's not like buy for me, schedule a consult, you know, flash sale, all this stuff. Right. It's, hey, have you thought about this? Oh, here's a home maintenance tip. Oh, here's something to think about when you do a remodel. Then
the whole maintenance tip. And even like, here's a list of questions to ask yourself. If you're considering a remodel, or what are the things you need to consider if you're wanting to put in new windows or shutters or whatever, siding. So there's a lot of different topics, and there's so much information out there that could help create that content too. So it's not like you'd have to start necessarily from ground zero. Yeah. All right. So that's long-term, short-term. We had said Google Ads and getting yourself on so that when people do keyword searches, you're coming up on there. And also asking for direct referrals from previous clients, associates, and that your strategy around that is let them know how many spaces you have open. So it's just that being intentional.
Yeah. And maybe even for what types of projects.
Yeah. All right. I love this. Thank you. I knew this was going to be a great conversation to have with you. Before we wrap up, is there anything, well, a couple of things, anything else you want to add? And if people want to reach you, where can they reach you? And I think you had a free resource that you can offer people.
Yeah. So you can always find us at builderfunnel.com, and there's tons of stuff there that you can find, content, podcasts, videos, you name it. If you like marketing or want to learn more about marketing and you hate it, but you're like, I know I need to do it, then that's a good spot to start. You asked me a couple of other questions. If I wanted to add anything else, I would say I would just maybe, aside from all the stuff we talked about today, I would highly encourage you to think about getting in front of the camera and committing to video as a part of that educational strategy, because you'll actually start to build a personal brand that is probably more powerful than the company brand. And if you think about it, if you are an owner, you are pretty good at sales, you are good with people, you connect, you can actually build all of that before somebody meets you. And it's really powerful once they do. So just a plug to try to get into video. And then, yeah, we have a free website grader on our site. And I can get you the link if you want to drop that in the notes.
Put the link down here.
Takes like 10 seconds. You can pop your site in there and get a score.
Awesome. Thank you. That's really wonderful. That's a great way for people to kind of just sort of jumpstart getting a sense of, is my website working for me the way I want it to?
Yeah.
Spencer, thank you. This has been awesome. I really appreciate you taking the time to share your wisdom and your ideas and thoughts with the audience who listens to The Profit Builder. We are also on YouTube, which is kind of fun. So I think that having videos on YouTube is a great way. I learn a lot there. So I think your idea there is great.
Cool. Right. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Thank you again. I hope you found today's video and my interview with Spencer helpful. And in next week's video, we're going to continue our journey on how to plug the profit leaks in your contracting business. And we're going to talk about sales, and we're going to talk about how to have a sales process that will stack the odds in your favor of being able to close more jobs. And that will be my interview with Jeff with Sandler Sales. And make sure to check that out. It'll be out next week. Thanks again for being here today, and I look forward to continuing to support you on your journey to building a great contracting business.